So good morning once again all the participants. Today is again welcome to day 4 of online AECTE sponsored online short term training program, second series on electromagnetics, microwaves, RF and antenna design. So today is actually one more simulation tool as a CST microwave studio. So Jyoti Electronics is given to the demonstration on that, and also some of the participants in the session season 1, they asked that MIMO type of antennas, all these things. So that actually second session is going to take that, particularly in the afternoon session. I request all the participants, please utilize this particular 2 sessions on this particular day, which is a very important. I don't know how many you have contact with the CST microwave studio, how many you have used that particular one. Generally almost all 80% to 90% of the people are using that HFSS, but today it is an fortunate day to you how to use that CST microwave studio. CST is a very easy where I should work in the CST studio. Some of the things we can easily design in this particular platform as an antenna design, especially. So my sincere request is please utilize this particular one. Now I request Ms. Priyanka to give that introduction about our today's speaker, and then we will hand it over to the Karthik sir. Priyanka, please.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, one and all. I welcome you all to the morning session of online STTP. In this session, we have Mr. Karthik Goyal, sir, with us. He is an application engineer at Jyoti Electronics, Ahmedabad. Karthik, sir, is an experienced technical expert of RF and microwave domain with a specialization in microwave engineering during M.Tech post-PG. He was associated with SRMS Trust Institutions, Uttar Pradesh, as an assistant professor for a duration of 4 years. Currently, he is working as an application engineer for CST Studio Suite at Jyoti Electronics, Ahmedabad, where he handled the technical discussions and queries from different labs and the Ministry of Defense with Government of India. And he also deals with research labs of premier academic institutions across the India. Also, he delivered on-site and off-site trainings on CST Studio Suite to the research scholars affiliated to IITs, NITs, as well as all institutions having research labs at high national and international repute. He had a specialized hands-on CST microwave wizard studio on the applications covering RF, optical antennas, plasmonics, photonics, microwave photonics, and communication systems. I cordially welcome you to the session, sir.
Thank you, Priyanka, ma'am, for introducing me to the gathering. Thank to Professor Hanumanta Rao, sir, as well, for giving us an opportunity to discuss about CST Studio Suite and its wide range of features. And thereafter, we will be discussing multiple designs, multiple modeling concepts. So thank you, sir, for giving us this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Once again, what is that actually our participants are regularly, what their fashion is? When you are going to present, their mute their microphones and also switch off their videos, sir, for smooth running of the presentation. Yeah. And if they have any doubts, they will post into the chat box, sir.
Yeah, sure.
After completion of your entire presentation, question by question, we will explain, and then you should clarify those doubts,
sir. Sure,
this is regularly our participants are doing. So if anyone wants to ask directly, they will ask at the end of the session, sir.
Sure.
So this is the regular, what we are doing, that we are explained just now. That's all, sir. Now you can start your presentation, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Very good morning to all the participants, to the dignitaries from the organizing institution, dignitaries from the collaborating institution, Jyoti Electronics, Ahmedabad. A very good morning to each and everyone.
My name is Kartik Goyal and I'm working as an application engineer at Jyoti Electronics, Ahmedabad. So during the course of the day, I have been allotted two sessions. In the first session, we would be discussing multiple features, multiple capabilities of the platform, CSG Studio Suite. And thereafter, we would be designing few of the antennas with complete, while following the complete steps from scratch to the advanced one to give you the glimpse of the modeling. And in the second session, starting from 2 onwards today, we would be discussing few advanced designs in terms of MIMO concepts, right? We would be discussing multiple concepts in terms for MIMO, either it is for 4G or 5G communications. So this would be the agenda for the day. But before starting into the concepts of CSG Studio Suite, let me brief you about that what we people at Jyoti Electronics do, how we are serving the Indian markets in the fields of RF and microwave, since when we are serving the Indian markets. So as you can see, we are into the techno trading distributions from the last 35 years, and we have diversified our energy into the fields of RF and microwaves since 2000. And when I talk about we have diversified our energy into RF and microwaves, it means whatever it is required at the domain, either it is some software, some specialized softwares, or some hardwares, either it is connector, cables, housings, or antennas, or whatever it is at the domain, we would be there to help you guys. So we provide complete solutions to bring you into the domain, from covering the entire range of the frequencies. When I say entire range of the frequencies, it means from very statics to the very high frequencies of up to 330 gigahertz, right? So in covering entire range of frequency, we have multiple circuit simulation tools, we have multiple system simulation tools, EM simulation tools, and few antenna designing tools as well we have, and on which you can design any of the antennas, any of the shapes, any of the physical appearance you can think of, you can design on the platforms. We also provide, as I said, we also provide the complete range of the hardwares, either it is a small connector or it is a test and measurement instrument. We can provide you everything into the domain. These are the main products, these are the main softwares that we people deal in. All these belongs to Dassault Systems, the one who sold Rafael to Government of India. The main flagship product is CSG Studio Suite, which is much more capable of handling wide range of applications at microwave frequencies. When I say wide range of applications, so whether it is antennas, or whether it is optical applications, whether it is periodic structures, whether it is RCS calculations, or a specific absorption rate, or whatever, if you say some active devices in terms of klystrons, traveling wave tubes, magnetrons, electron guns, everything can be simulated over here in CSG Studio Suite in its different studios that we would be discussing in a while. Thereafter, we have Opera. It's a low frequency electromechanical simulator where some sort of accelerators, transformers, actuators can be very easily designed, modeled, and simulated. Thereafter, we have Spark 3D. This particular platform is specially designed for the particle analysis. When I say particle analysis, then yes, it clearly means that there would be some interaction between the freely moving electrons and the RF beam. So there is a term called multipaction and corona analysis. When I say corona, it's not COVID-19, it's a discharge of the electrons in gas. So multipaction and corona analysis, you need to have a Spark 3D. Thereafter, we have FEST 3D. It is another specialized tool designed for the cavity based structures, some sort of filters that are created through cavities, some sort of waveguides, and some sort of other structures, including the cavity based structures, all are being designed and simulated very efficiently using FEST 3D. Thereafter, we have Antenna Magus. This is a very beautiful platform because it provides you the complete model without asking you about the dimensions that you are working on, right? It will ask you what are the desired performance parameters you are looking for. and what would be the resonating frequency. You need to input this, just these two things, that what are the desired parameter performances and what would be the resonating frequency, and depending over that, it will completely synthesize the entire model automatically, and thereafter you can take that model into the simulation window and can analysis and can put it under analysis for further performance measurements, right? Last but not the least, we have Abaqus platform designed for mechanical engineers who are looking for some discontinuities, looking for some deformations or some FE analysis sort of things. Then Abaqus is readily designed for that for those engineers. Now, as I said, that CSG is one of the globally used tool. So we have the users at SAC ISRO. We have the users at all the defense labs under DRDO. We have the users at BEL. We have the users at HAL, RRCAT, and all the premier academic institutions under Ministry of HRD, Government of India. Either it is IITs, NITs, IIITs, all the institutions are having our users. And now, without wasting much time on the briefing, let's talk about CSG Studio Suite, computer simulation technology software presented by Dassault Systems under the name of Simulia, right? Everything, whatever you are looking for, CSG, any details, you can look it at www.3ds.com. You can search it on. So, as I said you, that CSG is the tool that is globally used, covering all the applicational areas, either it is automotive, aerospace, communication, defense, electronics, energy, or some multi-physics as well. When I say multi-physics, then it's yes, it has a multi-physics studio which where you need to apply some thermal sources, where you need to apply some heat sources, and you can check the effect of the temperature or the heat sources over the EM fields. So you can have multi-physics solvers as well. Also, it is covering the entire range from statics up to optical frequencies, as I already said. And it provides you the flexibilities to work on the PCBs as well, right? When I say PCB, then yes, you can import any sort of or any extension of the PCB layouts into its project manager window. And thereafter, you can put that particular layout by mounting the desired components under signal integrity analysis or power integrity analysis, or you can perform the basic rule checks, whether all the rules are justified or there is some violations of the rules. So you can put a PCB under test as well. You can create multiple cables, either it is a single wire cable or it is twisted pair cable or some cable bundles or cable assemblies. You can develop all such things on CSG itself on its Cable Studio platform. Also, you can design actuators, machines, sensors, inductors on its low frequency studio called CST EM Studio, which is especially designed for low frequency applications, very similar to Opera platform, right? And also you can put the designs under test for SAR analysis or for RCS analysis. RCS analysis is for the radar, radars, and you can put a ship, you can mount or you can implant an antenna on any of the positions on the platform, and you can put it under test. You can put an antenna, making it wearable or implantable, and put the model under the test for SAR analysis. Everything can be done over here in CSG Studio Suite. So as I said, that for different applications, CSG has different studios. I named them as CSG Microwave Studio, CSG Cable Studio, PCB Studio, and physics studio. So likewise, we have different studios depending over different applications, right? So under the CSG Studio Suite tag, we have five major studios. The very first one is CSG Microwave Studio, where any sort of antennas, any sort of microwave passive components can be designed and can be analyzed with multiple performance parameters. Thereafter, we have CSG PCB Studio and Cable Studio, designed for the calculations of SI and PI analysis, or design for the calculation of EMIMC sort of things. We have CSG PCB Studio and Cable Studio. Thereafter, we have CSG Particle Studio, especially designed to study the interaction of EM fields with freely moving charges. when I say PC particular studio, then you can use this particular studio to the analysis of traveling wave tubes, to the for the analysis of electron guns, Pierce gun, or magnetrons, all sort of the active devices you can design and you can put under test using particle studio. Thereafter, we have CST EM studio designed for the low frequency applications. And last but not the least, we have CST M physics studio, where thermal or mechanical analysis or effects of thermal and mechanical sources on the EM fields can be studied very efficiently. Combining all these five studios, we have another very intelligent tool or a very intelligent studio called CST Design Studio that is specially designed at the circuit level simulation to create multiple co-simulations within different studios, right? Suppose we have an antenna and we want to check its performance in the presence of some lumped or circuit level components like resistors or capacitors, inductors, or some switches. So we can use CST Design Studio. We can import the design antenna in CST Design Studio. There you can connect multiple lumped or circuit level components, and further you can put or you can create another project out of the lumped and the elements, lumped elements and the antenna, to create another project into CST Micro Studio, which is called a co-simulation, right? So this sort of co-simulations sort
Karthik, sir. Please wait. I request all the participants. Is actually audio is not coming. We will wait. Sari is going to join with a mobile phone. We will wait for 2 more minutes. Meanwhile, Sari is joining. Karthik sir, your voice is not there. No voice.
Hello.
Sir, Karthik sir.
Sir, actually it's continuously raining from the last night. So there are some
restrictions in the... Yes, here also the same thing, but we will, no problem. We will wait for 2 minutes. It's not an issue, sir. Continue, sir. Please.
Okay. So I was talking about the different studios of CST, studio suite, under which multiple studios that I have discussed. So few are the elements that you can design. Few are the just the examples that you can design on CST Microwave Studio, right? Any sort of microwave passive components, either it is filter or tunnel devices, either these are the waveguides or the antennas you can design on Microwave Studio. Thereafter, we have another tool or another studio called CST EM Studio for low frequency applications. You can design these sort of components over there. Now we have another tool called CST Particle Studio, where all the active devices under the range of the microwaves can be designed. Thereafter, we have CST Amphitheater Studio. As I said, the effects of thermal sources or mechanical sources can be analyzed on the EM fields. And now this is the intelligent tool that I was talking about, CST Design Studio, where some antenna optimizations can be done, where some planar devices can be easily created at the circuit level simulation, or where some sort of amplifiers using the lumped components can be designed. These are the lumped components that you can see. The reddish, the red arrows are the lumped components over the planar circuitry that you can mount and you can put under test for different variations. This is a CST PCB Studio, designed for the signal integrity, designed for the effects of EMIMC or power integrity analysis you can perform on PCB Studio. Last but not the least, CST Cable Studio we have, where multiple different sort of cables, twisted pair cables, coaxial cables, cable bundles can be designed and can be put under test for EMIMC effects, right? Since we are committed to CST Microwave Studio for the course of the day, so we'll talk about different application-based solvers that you can pick on to justify the need of the R. Means, suppose if you are looking for the solutions of some biomedical applications, where you have some antenna, you need to put it on some biomodels. So how you can put, which solver is to be used, because that time the electrical size will increase. So how you can justify the need of the solvers, that is quite important. So at Microwave Studio platform, we have 6 different solvers that are very feasible to work on. And the broadly classified sections are 2. The very first one is general purpose solvers, and the next one is special solvers, right? When I talk about general purpose solvers, then 2 major solvers are being categorized in this category. The very first one is transient solver, and the next one is frequency domain solver. Transient solver is quite similar to time domain solver. We generally call it as time domain solver, and the next one is frequency domain solver. Both the solvers are working on different numerical techniques. If I say transient solver is working on FIT technique, and your frequency domain solver is working on FEM technique. Both the solvers are using different numerical techniques, due to which both the solvers have different discretization methods. When I say discretization, it means if you have a complete structure, if you have an antenna, then to apply the Maxwell equations, then to apply the boundary conditions for the solutions, you cannot apply boundary conditions on the entire antenna, right? What you can do, you can discretize the entire and complete antenna into different or into very smaller sizes, and you can pick a size, you can pick a smaller element, can apply Maxwell equations, boundary conditions, solve for that particular element, and can then integrate over the entire range, right? So that sort of discretization is different in both the solvers. Transient solver occupies the needs of hexahedrons while making the discretization, while time domain, while frequency domain.
I think same problem.
Time domain and frequency domain solvers, there are a few different differences. The next one is that when you look for the resonating antenna, right? It should work on a single frequency, or it may be a case that your antenna would be working on multiple frequencies. So it's the idea that we get through calculations. It's the idea that we have already with us through multiple literature surveys, right? So frequency domain solver is specially recommended for the narrow band structures or the single resonating structures. Or your time domain solver is recommended for the structures which have the wide band characteristics, which may have the multi-band characteristics, or which may have characteristics. It means, if I quote an example, then horn antenna, the very conventional horn, if you know this, if you have seen the characteristics of the horn, then you may remember that it possesses the broadband characteristics. So whenever we will go for horn antenna, either for lab purposes, either for using that particular horn as a feed to the reflectors, then we should use time domain solver for that particular thing. And one more difference among the transient solver and the frequency domain solver is, when we have, or when we create array of the structures, right? We have a unit element and we convert it into array with multiple excitations, right? So there is a difference between time domain and frequency domain solvers. The difference is, frequency domain solver is recommended for the structures having unit element only, while time domain solver is recommended for the structures having multiple excitations. Why is it so? Because frequency domain solver simulates the entire structure simultaneously. That means if you have n number of ports where the value of n is 10, let's say, then frequency domain solver will be solving all the excitations simultaneously at a time, due to which what will happen? It will be simulating the S parameters for 1, 2, 3 up to n ports simultaneously. That means the complexities among the S parameters will increase. And once the complexity increases, the simulation time will automatically increase. While your transient solver simulates the structure of multiple excitations in a sequential order. It will first create the S matrix for for excitation number 1. Then it will go up to excitation number 2, then it will go up to excitation number 3 up to n. So what will happen? The complexities will reduce and simulation runtime will automatically be reduced. And there is one more flexibility we have in time domain solver, which we will be using in session 2. What is there? Let's suppose you have 4 or n number of different excitations, while all the excitations are very identical to one another. I'm not saying symmetrical, I'm saying identical. When I say identical, it means the input amplitude of the source should be the same for all of the excitations. The phase variations among all the excitations should also be the same. And all these excitations should be excited on the very symmetrical structures. That means, that is the case of the MIMO antenna that we will see in the session, and we'll discuss further in the session itself. Now we have a very special solvers, especially designed for very particular applications. When I say eigen mode solver, especially designed for strongly resonating closed cavity based structures. When I say integral equation solver, that is designed for having characteristic mode analysis and CMA analysis, or where the electrical size of the structure is quite large, while we compare it with the lambda, then it should be of the order of 5 to 10 lambdas, right? Then your electrical size is large, then you should use integral equation solver, or to have CMA analysis. Thereafter, we have asymptotic solver, which is specially designed for RCS calculations. This asymptotic solver utilizes the technique of physics optics called shooting and bouncing ray mechanism, where multiple reflections or diffractions are considered. So shooting and bouncing ray is the technique utilized by asymptotic solver, while integral equation solver utilizes surface meshes to discretize your structures. Last but not the least, we have multi-layer solver designed and recommended for the structures where we have different layers of the substrates in the design. There are the cases where we have different layers of the different materials. So to solve such sort of structures, we are having a very specialized solver called multi-layer solver. So these are the parameters that defines the need of individual solvers. I have talked about electrical size. I have talked about the resonating behavior. I have talked about the material models, and yes, I have talked about the type of the meshes, either hexahedral, either tetrahedral or surface mesh. So depending over such parameters, you can choose your appropriate solver, you can start working on the same. Now, these are the general comparison between the general purpose solvers, time domain and frequency domain. I'll not talk about this because I have talked a lot about this slide already. Now, these are the shapes of the meshes that the different solvers utilizes. As I said, time domain solver utilizes the mesh called hexahedral meshing. Frequency domain and eigenmode solver utilizes tetrahedral meshing, and your integral equation solver utilizes your surface meshing, right? So this sort of meshing can be used using different solvers. Now, as we have discussed a lot about the different features or the concepts behind CSC Studio Suite, now we'll have a window where we can have the idea for the beginners, right? Those who are about to begin their work on CST, for that researchers, we have some getting started books where the detailed features, detailed analysis of different studios are given. Also, we have getting started videos as well that will give you the glimpse, that will give you the feel of the CST studio suite with different studios. Also, that will give you the glimpse or the feel of different modeling concepts as well, right? Along with that, we have some tutorials and examples that are saved already in the platform to give you an idea that how do you model something, what would be the different performance parameters that you can look for different applications, right? So whenever you are looking for any of the application components, then you can search it. Suppose this is a window where an antenna component has been searched. So you can see there are multiple antenna elements are there. Either it is a single element using time domain solver, or a single element using frequency domain solver, or there could be an array, or there could be an antenna array combined. So depending over your requirement, whatever be the number of components that have been saved in the component library, all would be available on the screen, and you can download and you can open it as a project to put it under test for multiple analysis, right? I'll show you how we'll do that and what is the benefit of having a component from the component library to the project, and how we can verify that what are the different steps that have been followed to create such model. Now, this is a very important feature that we have in CSC Studio Suite, that on every pop-up window, that at every window, there would be available a option for help. Once you click help button, it will automatically redirect to the defined page. Suppose in this time domain solver parameters, this is a dialog box where help button is there. So it will automatically redirect it to the linked page where time domain solver parameters details are given, and you can look for each of the individual tab details here on the page. The main important feature of this particular online help is this is not only available online, but it is offline available as well. You need not to connect via internet to access this help menu. You can connect it in offline mode as well. So now this is the general EM simulation workflow, right? Everyone is doing some sort of research, so everyone is aware of the things. I'll not discuss much about that, but I'll discuss about this particular EM simulation tab, right? It has the four steps. The very first step is you need to calculate the dimensions. You need to develop a virtual prototype that has to be modeled, that has to be designed over CSG. So some dimensional calculations are required to develop this virtual prototype. Thereafter, once you have the virtual prototype or the dimensions, you will have the idea about the electrical size of the structure with comparison to lambda. So depending over the electrical size of the structure to be modeled, you can choose a better solver. So the solver choice can be made. Thereafter, solver settings. That means once you choose the solver, then what would be the boundary conditions? What would be the range of the frequency in which the design is to be simulated, and what would be the discretization method, either it is hexahedral, tetrahedral, surface mesh, whatever it would be. All these things are to be set, and thereafter you design your model, you simulate it, and you analyze it for further results, right? So this would be the thing that we would be doing during EM simulations. And this is the common user interface of CST Microwave Studio, where this is the project manager. This is your primary window where you will be designing everything. This would be the ribbon bar. There are multiple options to develop your model would be given. This is the navigation window where whatever you have done, all would be available here in the navigation window. If you have modeled something, it would be available in components. If you have created some curves, it would be available in curves. If you have created some sources, some excitations you have given, then it would be available here in the ports, right? So such things would be available here. And last but not the least, we have some parameter list. Then that would be good enough available with you while you input some of the variables while designing the model. So we will see how do we design models through variable assignments. And now this would be the pie chart that would be very quickly available if I show you. Then if I click on new and the new template would be there, then this would be the template or this would be the pie chart that would be available on your screens. If I show you, these are the five different studios under CST Studio Suite. This is CST Microwave Studio, where all sort of microwave applications are here. Either it is antennas, either circuits and components, either for RCS calculations, for biomedical exposure and SAR, for optical applications and periodic structures. And every specific application has further classifications of the designs. Suppose if I enter into optical applications, then either you wish to design your structure through some metals only or some plasmas, or you wish to design through dielectric structures only. So this sort of application based designs are already given. If I show you in periodic structures, then either you are looking for FSS or metamaterial unit cell, or you are looking for FSS full structure or metamaterial full structure. So depending over that, you can choose accordingly. Suppose you need to design metamaterial cell unit cell, metamaterial based unit cell, click it on. Then it will ask you whether you are looking for dispersion diagram or you are looking for phase reflection diagram. So for general categories, we look for dispersion diagrams where the relation between phase and the frequencies would be defined. So that can be done over here in CST as well accordingly. Now, if you are looking for metamaterial based full structure, you can see that for smaller models whose electrical size is not so much large, then frequency domain solver is recommended. And for other structures where the electrical size is larger in comparison to lambda, then time domain solver would be recommended, right? So depending over your application, you can choose the solvers. Now, this is CST Cable Studio and PCB Studio, where you can create cables, you can put the PCBs under rule checks, or you can put a PCB under SIPI analysis, this is another studio called CST AMI-MC Studio. These two studios combinedly are making CST PCB Studio, CST Cable Studio, right? So these two studios are very important for having cables and for having PCBs. Now, this is a studio which is specially designed for particle analysis, where interaction of EM fields with the freely moving charges would be studied. And last but not the least, this would be the studio for low frequency applications, right? So all such things can be would be there. Also, let me show you the component library. This would be the component library. If I search it here for filters, then these are the filter components that are available for me in my design. These are the filter components, right? If I need to open any of the filters, that how can I? What can I do? I can just click on this, download a copy of the latest revision, download a copy, and just then open it as a project. Open as a project. So as you see, it is opening, and finally it is here. This is now open. This is a bent pass filter triplet having three different layers. So this is created now. What you can do, you can Now check the what are the different blocks that were used to create the model. These are the different blocks that were used to create the model. Some resonators, some coupling structures were there. And what is up to? It is analyzed for some optimization. Some optimization schemes are being applied to done the final simulation. So similarly, there are multiple applications, there are multiple projects that are already saved and you can work on further, right? So this was the window that I have just discussed. Now, once you enter into the main project window, there you have some primitives to design your model, directly some 3D primitives to design your model, some cones, some cylinders, some bricks, some spheres, all such things can be designed. Now, these are few viewing options that you how you like to view your object or how do you like to view your model that you have created. If you are willing to have it at a cutting plane, you can view. If you want to check the intersections within the designs, then you can look for the wireframe mode. You can see, you can look, you can show your design through the working plane. There are some research article journals where the working plane is not considered because it degrades the image quality. So you can hide the working plane for such things. Also, either you are looking to have your structure through with coordinate axis or without coordinate axis. So all such things you can do. This is another viewing option, which is show or hide shapes, which is very helpful when we are looking for some intersections among the different cores of the model, right? Suppose we have some designs which is having multiple cores and I need to check whether the two innermost cores are intersecting or coinciding with one another. So what we can do, we can hide all the topmost layers of the model and we can only have the two innermost layers of the model onto the project now. We can check and thereafter we can again show all the corresponding models. Also, you can hide all the dielectrics at the same time. You can hide all the metallic structures of the model at the same time to have a view of the dielectric ones separately. Now, this sort of thing you people can perform. And now, this is something called PIX applications. This is very interesting for me because I'm not good at coordinate geometry, right? For those users who are not good at coordinate geometry, these have the facility, these can avail the facility of picking the options. Suppose you have modeled this block, right? You have modeled this block. Now I need to start or I need to model keeping this particular point as the starting point. So, and I don't know the coordinates. So what I can do, I can pick this particular edge or I can pick this particular corner with this sort of with this sort of coordinates. I can align a local coordinate system to that particular point. You see, a local coordinate system has been applied to the selected corner. And now this particular corner would be considered as the origin of the model. And from here itself, you can create the corresponding models. You can activate or deactivate the local coordinate system n number of times through that modeling. We'll see, we'll do this sort of thing during some modeling while we will be modeling some structures, right? So you can activate or deactivate the local coordinate system at any of the points, either it is at the corner, either it is the midpoint of the edge, or either it is the center point of a face. So you can choose accordingly. Also, you have the flexibility to move your local coordinate system at different points. You can translate your local coordinate system. You can rotate your local coordinate system along the axis, right? Thereafter, few of the very basic Boolean operations, some addition, subtraction, insertions, intersections, or trimming of the objects can be done, right? So these are available in all of the conventional EM simulators we have. Now, these are few of the curve modeling tools and which are the planar ones, and these curves can be converted into the 3D models using extrusion. These curves can be simulated can be converted into 3D models. For that, first you need to create a sheet out of planar curve that is available, that option is available, and thereafter you can convert that sheet or that planar curve into a solid model through extrusion, or you can also create a 3D model by performing a sweeping of the curve along the path of the line. This is the curve. This is a path that has been given to this curve. So it will be sweeped up to a solid model following this particular path. So you can see following this particular path, then model has been created. Now, these are a few of the advanced modeling tools called blending and chamfering. Once you are looking to cut any of your edge of the project at an slant height, then you can use chamfering, or if you want to blend it, if you want to give us some radial component at all the edges, then you can perform blending of the edges by getting some appropriate radius. Now, these are the transform operations for the models. Any model, any object can be transformed, can be translated from one position to another. It can be rotated in any of the directions. It can be scaled by any of the scaling factor, or any of the mirror images can be created for any of the objects, right? So these are the transform operations that we have. Another modeling tool, advanced modeling tool called shelling, especially used when we are looking to create some hollow structures. It makes the structures hollow wherever we apply the shelling. If you can see, there were three objects, the solid one, solid two, solid three. These were three different objects. We have performed a Boolean operation to make them in a single one. Now this is a single one object. Now we have done, we want to make it hollow through the design, the hollow magnet, we want magnet sort of shape we wanted to create. So what we have done, we have picked the two faces. From this face to this face, we want a hollow structure, and we have just performed the shelling, and now you can see a hollow structure has been developed. So this could also be done. Thereafter, we have loft operation, another advanced modeling tool, especially required when we don't know what would be the intermediate geometry between the two corresponding models. Suppose this is a rectangular waveguide. This is a cylindrical waveguide sort of thing. And we want to model a corresponding geometry in between two objects placed a distance apart. When we have two objects and having an appropriate distance between these two, then we can perform loft operation to create an intermediate geometry like here we have done. So such thing can be utilized to develop horn antennas. And we'll see how we'll do. And then another modeling tool called bending. You can perform bending of the planar sheets on the solids. You can perform the bending on the curved surfaces of sheets. We have a curved surface. This is a sheet. You can perform the bending over the sheet over the surface. Now, so after having multiple ideas about the modeling concepts, then what do we have to excite your designs? We have given birth to an object. We have given birth to a baby. Now we need to think about its food. So these feeding techniques, these feeding options are the foods for the designs, for the antennas, for the filters that we will be modeling. So there are two types of excitations that we can use. The very first one is discrete ports or the lumped ports, and the second one is waveguide ports. Both the sources, both the excitational methods have their different aspects when you are using discrete ports. As you can see, voltage and current would be considered as the output, right? Or when you are looking for waveguide ports, then you would be looking for E field or H field patterns, some propagation constants, some line impedance sort of things we would be looking for, right? So the way of assigning the ports, this could be a way of assigning the discrete ports. You can pick two corresponding points. You can pick a face and a point. You can pick a face and an edge, or a point and an edge. You can see two in between the two edges, in between an edge and a face, a discrete port can be assigned. And this would be the window of the discrete port. Like now you see, there is one very important thing to mention here, that you can control the impedance of the discrete port. This thing is not available in waveguide port. a waveguide port would be having the impedance very similar to the geometry of the, or very similar, very equal to the impedance of the geometry on which you need to apply the field, right? I'll show you that how. So this is something that you can control the impedance of the discrete ports, while you cannot control the impedance. This is the window for the waveguide port. Here you see there is no any option of having the impedance into the picture. So these are the ways of assigning the waveguide ports. Again, it can be assigned over in between two edges at multiple points or at a face, and all would be looking like this only, right? So this is one of the way of assigning the waveguide ports, and this is another way of assigning the waveguide ports. Like suppose you have a very thinner face over which you need to assign the waveguide port, right? And you need to mention, you need to note it down that a waveguide port or any of the excitational port is also considered in discretization. When we apply the meshing techniques, then whatever the ports will be used in the design, these ports would also be considered for discretizations. And when we have a very thinner face over which we need to apply a port, then after application of the port would not be discretized due to very smaller in size. So what we can do, we can extend the port by a extension factor called K. K is the extension coefficient by which the port will, initially the port was on this particular part only. The port was on this particular part only. And now it has been extended to this region by the scaling factor K. How we do extend the port, I'll see in a while. And now these would be the results, some standard results. We will discuss all these results through the designs. There's some results through some result monitors. And some result templates would be there. So we will not talk about this now. We'll quickly move on to the designing of a few of the structures. Let me give you the idea that what we would be designing. Then guys, we would be designing a very simple microstrip patch antenna first, using CST Studio suit. And this patch would be designed through different approaches of modeling, through the use of local coordinate systems, through the use of transformations. I'll show all the cases. And thereafter, we'll put the patch for parameterization as well. We'll see the results for optimizations as well. That means this patch, what is I'm showing and what is about to show you, this is the complete picture of the antennas. You will have the idea that what we can do, what we need to do in an antenna for having the best outputs, right? We'll see everything through this. And these are the dimensions that we would be creating for the patch. The material for the substrate would be RTD-580, having a thickness of 0.787 mm with the permittivity of 2.2, and the loss tangent is 0.0015, right? And the dimensions of the substrate would be 40 cross 40 in terms of length and width. And this would be the dimensions for the ground plane that is under the substrate in terms of length and width, while the ground plane would be of the material called copper. And this copper would be having a thickness of 0.035 mm. And same material would be used for the radiating patch that is having a dimensions of 20 cross 20. And with a thickness of 0.035 mm again. So let's create these three components first. We'll create a ground plane. Then we'll create a substrate on the top of the ground plane. And on the top of the substrate thereafter, we will create the radiating element. Let's design these three components first. So this would be your CST window. This would be your CST window, as you can see. So I'll enter into the new template. Now I enter into microwaves, RF and opticals, since this is the microwave studio that we are focusing on. Now we'll, as I need to develop a microstrip patch antenna, so I'll enter into antennas. In antennas, since we know the patch is a planar component, right? So the planar patch I need to create. And as we know, as we all know that a patch is something that has a very resonating behavior. And what are the dimensions I have chosen? These are the dimensions that may have multi-bands or multiple resonating frequencies that may have. So what I can do, I can select time domain for multi-bands antennas. It may have a multi-bands. So just click, okay. Now the dimensional space you can set. So my dimensions are in mm, gigahertz, nanoseconds. So okay. Now the resonating or the frequency range of interest is 1 to 8 gigahertz from this particular design that we are about to create. And now these are the monitors, right? Whether we are looking for E fields, H fields, far fields. Far fields means when, whether we are looking for some directivity, some gain components. So yes, I'm looking for the E field. As soon as I, you see, as soon as I click E field, then there are some frequency range one defined at 1 gigahertz, 4.5 gigahertz and 8 gigahertz. These are the field monitors, right? Over which we will be having E field, we would be having H field, we would be having far field. Also, I want this, all these E field, H field and far field and 4.9 gigahertz. You can add these field monitors at the later stage as well. Click next. This is a summary and finish. So now you see, this is the primary window where we would be modeling everything, right? So I just eliminate this need of this working plane from the view options. I can eliminate the need of this working plane. I have eliminated the need of the working plane, right? Now, the very first thing that I need to model is my ground plane, which is having the dimensions of 40 cross 40 cross 0.035. So I'll create a block. In the modeling tab, I'll create a brick. I'll press escape. Now name it as ground. Now X min and X max. Now just remember that this particular reddish in this, at the center of the screen is the origin, right? So to keep that origin at the center of the ground plane, what I'll do, I'll try to put the symmetrical design in with respect to the coordinate axis. And for that purpose, since the length of the ground plane is 40, so what I can do, I can make it from minus 20 to 20, making a combine of 40. Similarly, width is 40, so minus 20 to 20. And now the ground plane thickness is 0.035, so it would be starting from 0 to 0.035. And the material would be either PEC, perfectly electrical conducting. It's an ideal thing, so we'll not consider the ideal concepts, but rather we will try to incorporate some practical aspects. So for that particular thing, I'll looking for the copper in the material library. You can see there is a wide material library available of the different materials. So out of that, I am looking for copper as a material, copper annealed. I will be looking for lossy metal. And let's have a preview. So this would be, okay. This would be my ground plane. And now the idea is that on the top of the ground plane, I need to have the substrate having the dimensions of 40 cross 40 as well. So what I can do, I can again create a brick, escape, name it as substrate. And now since the dimensions are same, so from minus 20 to 20, from minus 20 to 20. And now Z min would be the end point of the ground plane at which the ground plane is ending, right? End point of the ground plane. So end point of the ground plane is 0.035. It was starting from zero and moves up to 0.035. And now my substrate will start from 0.035 and it will go up to 0.035 plus 0.787. This would be my substrate. And the material for the substrate is RT duret 5880. So I can look for 5880 and I'll use the lossy material. Click OK. And now you see the preview first. Then this is the ground plane. And on the top of the ground plane, there would be a substrate. Click OK. And now you see on the top of the ground plane, this is the ground plane and this is the substrate. So on the top of the ground plane, there lies a substrate. Right? So now finally, I'm on to something where I need to create a patch. I need to create the radiating element. So for the red radiating element, again, I need to have a brick. Name it as patch. And the dimensions of the patch is now 20 cross 20 cross 0.035. That means, again, to keep the symmetry, let's make it from minus 10 to 10, minus 10 to 10, and from 0.035 plus 0.787. Because now the patch will start from the end point of the substrate, right? So that is why it is starting from 0.035 plus 0.787. It will go up to 0.035 plus 0.787 plus. Now the thickness of the patch is 0.035. And the material of the patch would again be the copper. Let's preview. Okay. Now, this is my patch, right? The ground plane, the substrate, and on the top of the substrate, you can see on the top of the substrate, there lies the patch. Now, what are the other things that we need to create? The other things are that I need to have the feed lines. I need to have the feed line with the which are having the length as 17.5 and the width of 2.38. Also, I need to have some slots this along with the feed line which are having the length of 7.50 and a width of 0.5. So we'll develop these sort of things as well again in this corresponding model. So now you see, first we'll create a feed, right? So the feed will be starting from this position, and it will be going beyond this, right? The feed would be lying here. So for that, again, I need to create a brick because it would be a microstrip line of the thickness of 0.035. So let's name it as feed line. Now, my X min would be, at this point, my X min would be minus 20. And it would be going up to minus 20 plus 17.5. This is the length of the feed line. Now my Y min is having the width of the feed line, which is 2.38. Keeping the symmetry in mind, now I can add minus 2.38 by 2 to 2.38 by 2, right? And the thickness would be, it is again lying on the top of the substrate. That is why it would be starting from this position, and it would be going up to this position, and would be the of the material of copper. And let's preview. Now you see your feed line is here again. Your feed line is here again, and just click OK. So now you see, now let's talk about some practical aspects. That you see, your feed line and your patch are coinciding with one another. That means the copper is being wasted over here in terms of modeling now, because the copper was already here, and the copper for the feed has overlapped the copper for the patch. So what I can do, I can perform an addition. I can perform an addition of the patch and the copper. Now you see the extra copper has been omitted. So this is something called practical concepts. Now what I need to do, I need to create the slots. I need to create the inserts, and these inserts would be lying on both the sides of the feed line on the patch. So the inserts would be lying here as well. This sort of inserts would be on the both the sides of the feed line. So for that, now, if I ask you that what are the coordinates of this particular point, because I need to model the slot from here, so I don't know. So what I can do, I can pick a point. I can pick a point. Now I can activate. If you see, I can activate the local coordinate. The local coordinate system is lying at the origin right now. What I can do, I can align this WCS with the picked point. And now this particular point is zero for me. This particular point is 0, 0, 0 for me. And from here itself, again, I can create the inset of the slots. Let's name it inset one. Now U min is in the X direction. So it is having the length, and the length of the slot is 7.5. And now the width is in V, and it is having a width of 0.5. And now the thickness is, because it is now zero, so the thickness would be 0.035 of copper. Preview. And now you see, this would be the inset. Okay. This is the inset now, right? So now similar sort of insert I need to develop, I need to create on this side of the patch or the feed line as well. Again, I need to have these coordinates. What I can do, again, I pick this point. And now the local coordinate system was at this position. It would be aligned to now near position. And now this near position would be 0, 0, 0. This is the way that now again you develop an inset by putting appropriate dimensions. Or what you can do, you can just transform this inset. You can just transform this inset, or transform means you need to copy. You need to copy the inset at what position? Let's move it in Y. And if we zoom it, it is not appropriately moved. So if you see the exact dimensions, what it covered, it covered the entire width of the feed line. The entire width of the feed line was 2.38, plus it has covered the width of this slot, which is 0.5. And since we are moving in negative of Y, that is why the minus signs have been taken. And now preview. Okay. Now you see, both the inserts are here, and now you can cut, you can eliminate the need of these inserts because we need to create the slots over here. So what we can do, we can cut them, we can eliminate them from the patch. So feed line, click feed line, go into Boolean, go into subtract and select inset one and inset one underscore one and press enter. And now you see your inserts have been eliminated from here. So this is one of the approaches that we have adopted, right, to develop your patch. What could be another approach? Another approach is that you can create the entire geometry through variables. So what are the variables? How can we assign them? Let's do that thing. First, we created the ground. Open it. Define brick. Open it. The ground is minus 20 to 20, means half of the length of the ground in negative of x and half of the length of the ground in positive of x. So instead of minus 20, what I can do, minus LG, length of the ground by 2, half of the length of the ground to LG by 2. Similarly, minus WG by 2, half of the width of the ground to WG by 2, and from 0 to TG, thickness of the ground, right? Just click OK. It will ask, what is LG? It is 40, length of the ground. What is WG? It is 40, width of the ground. What is TG? It is thickness of the ground. And you see, there is no change in your design. Everything is like that only, right? So now you can create the substrate similar in a similar manner. You enter minus LS by 2 to LS by 2, negative of length of the substrate to negative of the positive of the length of the substrate, from minus WS by 2 to WS by 2, and it is from TG to TG plus TS, thickness of the ground to thickness of the substrate. And now you can click OK. What is LS? LS is 40, and 40 is already LG. So I can align LS is equals to LG, and LG is already 40. Click OK. What is WS? It is 40, which is equivalent to WG. This is variable assignment, right? And what is TS? TS was 0.787. Okay, fine. And now, similar sort of things you can perform on this feed line where you have created this patch first. It is minus 10 to 10, so it is minus LP by 2 to LP by 2, from minus WP by 2 to WP by 2, and it is from TG plus TS to TG plus TS plus TG. You can write it this way, or you can write it as TS plus twice of TG. Equation form you can also write. So now LP by 2, what is LP? LP is LG by 2, half of the ground plane. LG was 40 and LP is 20, so half of the ground plane. What is WP? It is WG by 2. Okay. And it is created. So now you can see that every parameter would be available here in the parameter list. So this is what you have assigned. You have assigned LG as 40, WG as 40. You have assigned LS as equivalent to LG. You have assigned WS as equivalent to WG. Likewise, you have done. Right? And now You can also do it for feed line. It is starting from minus of 20. That means minus of LG by 2 it was starting from. And it is going up to minus LG by 2 plus LF. LF is a new value. Right? And now it is minus WF by 2 to WF by 2. And now it is again from TG plus TS to TG plus TS plus TG. Now, LF is 17.5, WF is 2.38. Okay, fine. You see, your geometry is still the same. So, by this way, you can apply variables, right? The, now, last thing is that we have developed the model. The last thing that is left only, that I need to assign the excitation to this particular model. And the excitation would be assigned here. The excitation would be assigned on this thinner face of the feed line. Excitation would be assigned on this thinner face of the feed line. And for that, there could be two approaches, right? There could be two approaches to assign the excitation of the feed line. The first approach is you just pick the face. You can just pick the face. Just double click it on. Now face has been picked. You enter into simulation tab and a waveguide port is there. You apply, you open a waveguide port. Now you see it would be applied here and you apply it. Right? So this is the port that have applied, that has been applied by us on the microstrip patch. This is the port. If you open it again, if I show you something, then there is nothing to do with the impedance. Also, you can increase the number of modes in the design, right? You can increase the number of modes you are looking for in the design for the within the frequent range of frequency to be simulated, right? But for the sake of simplicity, I'll keep the modes as one only, right? So this is a way of assigning the waveguide ports where the phase over which the waveguide port is to be assigned is quite enough in size, but here it is very thin. So it would be a wrong way, a wrong approach to assign the waveguide port. That is why I can eliminate this waveguide port from here. What I can do, I can again pick this face over which I need to apply the waveguide port. Now, follow this. I can go into homes. I go into macros, in the solvers, in the ports, and there it is. We have calculate port extension coefficient. This will give me a factor, a coefficient by which the port would be extended in all the respective directions. If I click OK, then this was the window that I have shown during the presentations. And now, since you have picked the face, that is why it is automatically picked up the width of the feed line. This is the width of the feed line, which was 2.38. The thickness of the substrate, which was 0.787, and the permittivity of RT divided by 580, which is 2.2. And just calculate it. So the coefficient is 8.39 by which the port would be extended, and just construct port from picked face. And now you see, this is the exact port that is working well for this design, right? So now you can put this design under simulations. So for not wasting the time, I'll open already simulated similar design. I'll show you. Already simulated design for discussing the results. Now you see, this is the very similar design that we have just modeled, very similar design. So the very first thing that I'll show you in terms of impedance bandwidth, right? That is, either in terms of return loss, or first I'll show you that how much impedance it is matching up, and it is available here in the 1D results under the tab of reference impedance. If I open it, then it is, now you see, it is trying to match up to 50 ohms, not more than that, and it is matching up to 49 point something, right? But we haven't talked about, we haven't input any of the parameters that is called impedance in the ports or in the geometry. Then how it is trying to match up to 50, not 373 or not 300 or not 73 ohms. How is it possible? What we have done, something special that it is only trying to match up to 50 ohms. So that is very important to keep in mind. So let me show you something. That this is the strip or the feed line that you have modeled. This particular feed line that you have modeled, it is having an impedance of 50 ohms. How it is having an impedance of 50 ohms, right? Are you asking this? So let me show you. Calculate. Go into calculate analytical line impedance in the macros, right? Click on, these are the different geometries of the feeding mechanisms that we people may have. So I am having this sort of geometry, if you can see. The very thin microstrip I have created. So if I show you that depending over these three parameters, over the width, over the thickness and the permittivity, the impedance would be designed. So the width, thickness was of the substrate was 0.787, the width was 2.38 and the permittivity was 2.2 and the corresponding impedance was 50.91. Since the feed line was having the impedance of 50.91, that is why it is only trying to match up to 50 ohms, not 373 ohms or 73 ohms, right? This is the beauty of this line calculator, that you can calculate the dimensions of the geometry over which you need to apply the excitation as per the requirement of the impedance or as per the requirement of the codes that you are having in physical. Now, suppose if I try to check the impedance of a coaxial connector, I need to have a coaxial connector of 50 ohms, right? So what would be these dimensions? What would be the diameter of the inner pin that would be going up to the patch? What would be the diameter of the inner dielectric that would be going up to the substrate? So if I try to show you with this sort of dimensions, if I try to show you 0.787, 0.2.3 and 2.2, calculate, the impedance would be 44.74 only, but I needed 50. So what I can do, I can check it with this, whether it is 3.6, what it would be. It is 3.6 and now it is 61. I can make it 54. I can make it 2.9, 52. I can make it 2.7, 49. I can make it 2.75 and it is something 50 ohms now. Right? So these dimensions can be utilized to develop a coaxial connector having an impedance of 50 ohms during simulations. And keep that in mind that it would not be having any of the impacts of this line length. If I make it 500, if I make this line length up to 500 and if I try to calculate again, it would not affect this impedance. If I make the frequency up to 500 gigahertz, it would not impact my impedance. That means my impedance would only be dependent over the permittivity of the inner dielectric material, the diameter of the inner pin and the diameter, and these three parameters would be defining the impedance of the coaxial connector. And similarly, these three parameters would only be defining the impedance of my microstrip feed line that I have created. If I make it 1 lakh line length, if I try to calculate, it is not changing. I can make it 5 again, it is not changing. That means line length and frequency is nothing to do with the impedance of the line that I have created, right? Now, next thing is, the next result that I'll show you is the graph of the return loss or the reflection coefficient through which we can calculate the impedance bandwidth. And this is the return loss of this particular antenna that I have designed. It is radiating or it is resonating at a frequency of 4.96 with a return loss value of 31.642393 dB, or the reflection coefficient as 0.02616174618. Right? You can calculate the impedance bandwidth, or you can calculate the bandwidth of interest for this particular design as by adding two markers at minus 10 dB positions. This is one of the marker at minus 10 dB positions, and now I can add another marker at these two positions. These are having almost the positions of 10 dB. Yeah. So now you can check that almost a bandwidth of 700 megahertz, or sorry, almost a bandwidth of 70 megahertz is there, I guess. Right? So this is the bandwidth of interest. And now if you see the radiation efficiency of the design antenna, then this is the radiation efficiency of the design antenna, and this particular marker point, it is having a radiation frequency of 0.76%, and the total efficiency of the designed antenna is this much. Again, 0.76 at 0.956 gigahertz of frequency. Now, if I show you the VSWR curve, the voltage standing wave ratio, very important to define the performance of the antennas. Now you can see it is having a wide range of up to 2000, and at 4.9536 of frequency, it is having a VSWR of 1.08, and the standard says closer the value to 1, best the results. So I'm having a result of 1.08 of the VSWR, so it is having much more the best results. And now if I try to show you the e-field patterns, this is the e-field distribution. If you can visualize, this is the e-field distribution, and it is not feasibly properly visualizable, so I can make it in different aspects, and you can check it now if you can visualize it, and now it can be better visualized. So as the resonance definitions that says that at the center there should be nothing, but at the edges of the patch there would be the maximum in terms of e-field. So this is the justification of that particular statement. At the edges of the patch, we are having all the outputs in terms of e-fields, right? Similarly, we can see the flow of surface currents. And now you see, this is the surface current that we have, right? After discussing this e-fields, you can note the values of the e-fields from here. This is the chart that the maximum value would be at, would be 54,423.4 volts per meter, right? And at different angles, you can note the values, right? So now we'll talk about the port modes. We have used a single port, and for that, if I show you, then it would be much visualized through the arrows. And now you can see the rotation of the ports, or the arrows in terms of modes, right? Yeah, this is something, the port modes we can have. And now you can note the port mode type is quasi TEM mode. Now further, you can increase the number of modes, and you can have definitely, you will definitely have some modes, either TE or TM or whatever it is. You can study the modes further, right? And the frequency of this quasi TEM mode is 4 gigahertz. Right, with a line impedance of 49.0330337 ohms. So you can visualize this way. Now the next thing is how we can visualize the gain, the directivity, and other parameters. So all these parameters are available in the 3D results. So these are the results that are available through field monitors. These were the results that are standard ones. Now we have some far field results. In terms of far fields, if I try to show you the absolute value of directivity, you see, this is the directivity. This is the directivity option. And now this is the directional pattern of the antenna. If I show you the structure as well, then this is the directional properties of my antenna. It is having a directivity of 7.551 dBi, much higher with a single antenna. And the realized gain is 6.38 dBi, right? This could be one of the results, right? Also, there is another result in terms of axial ratios. This is the axial ratio graph. It is much appropriately seen through Cartesian, and you see it is having an axial ratio of all about 40 dBs throughout, right? Similarly, you can see it in polar as well, or any of the directivity properties can be seen in polar. This is the realized gain in terms of polar. this is the directivity in terms of polar, with having the main lobe direction as 0.0 degrees with the directive main lobe magnitude as 7.47 GPI, right? So these are the few parameters, performance parameters for a normal antenna, and all these performance parameters are far important, very important for all sort of antennas that you people design, that you people work on. These are the basic performance parameters in terms of antennas, right? Now, if I show you a few more results in terms of this performance or in terms of this antenna only, then what it would be? I'll show you a few of the results in terms of when I start talking about the parameterization and optimization, right? Since I have already applied the variables over here in the design, these are the variables that I have assigned. So now how can I apply parameterization? Let's see that. So parameterization is available here at in the home tabs as parametric sweep. So if I click it on, then it would be showing me this particular window. I'll click on new sequence, over the new sequence, new parameter, and whatever the variables you have applied in your design, all would be available here. You can apply the variable over any range. So I can apply a variable at LG, length of the ground, let's say. So it would be varying from, say, 45 to 55. It should vary with a sample size of 11, let's say. So click OK. So these would be the 11 samples over which the different results would be available for me. So just you can click start and it will simulate event 11 times the entire design to give you the 11 different results at different values of length of the ground. And if I show you this parameterization, then I'll show you it through the similar design with other templates. Again, it's a very similar design, right? I have created some parameterizations. And if I show you the results of S parameters at different values of the length of the patch, the parametric sweep that was applied for length of the patch, right? So these are the results that are for different variables of the length of the patch. And if I show you, then this is the initial value. This is the initial value, right? This was the initial result. And these are now the multiple results. So you can see these are the multiple results for the length of the patch, the multiple results for the different values of S parameters varying with the length of the patch, right? Similarly, you can check this S file for the reference impedance. Similarly, you can check for the VSWR, the maximum multiple results. You can check one or you can check the multiple as well, right? You can check. Now, you cannot check the directivity. Directivity was, this was the directivity, right? This was the directivity. You cannot check it for with multiple parameters. It would only be available for a single value. Why is it so? Because it's the direction, far field properties. So how can I have the gain? How can I have the directivity for, during parameterization? For that, we need to use the post-processing. What is post-processing? Post-processing is a window that gives me the flexibility to develop few advanced parameters, few other performance parameters of a design. So if I talk about the gain over the frequency, then you can enter into this post-processing. You can enter into result templates. And now you can enter into far field and antenna properties in the first section. And in the second tab, you can set far field result. Then there would be a pop-up window. There is a pop-up window where a maximum gain over frequency is asked. Maximum gain over frequency is asked. Just double click it on it and it would be added up here like this. It is added up here like this and it is already evaluated. I need not to evaluate that. So let me show you first. In the tables, it would be available in the 1D results. Then this is the maximum gain over frequency with different values, right? So first, let's see it for a single value. So this is for LP is equals to 16. This is for LP is equals to 15. This is for LP is equals to 15, right? This is front to back ratio over frequency for LP is equals to 15. This is maximum gain over frequency for LP is equals to 15. And now you can have multiple results of the maximum gain over frequency, right? So this is the way that you apply that. How do you get the results that are not available in parameterization due to their properties? So how can you get the results in 1D to have them in parameterized fashion, right? So this is the way of parameterization. Now, let me show you that how do you assign the optimization of a design. So this is the optimizer tab. You open it, then it would be asking you the variables that you have assigned out of which over which or which variable you are looking for to be optimized, right? So I'm looking for this length of the patch to be optimized. And it should be optimized within the range of 15 to 25. Initial value was 20. So it should be optimized within the range of 15 to 25 for me. And now if you can select multiple parameters as well. You can select multiple variables as well for the goals. And now entering into the goals, I have added up a goal already. So how you can add a goal? So just see, have a look, add a new goal. Now, whatever be the 1D results available in your design, all would be available here. You can optimize any of the results according to the variable, right? So let's say optimize this VSWR. It should have a value equal to 1. This is the ideal value, right? Which is not possible, but yes, we are still looking for over the entire range of the frequency. Just click OK. And now just click start and it will start optimizing your design. It will start optimizing the variable LP to give you the best value of the VSWR, which is much closer to 1, right? So I'll show you the optimizer results now. These optimizer results are available in the 1D section. You can see these are the in the 1D section, in the 1D results, this is the optimizer tab. And you see these are the results. So the parameters, this was the parameter, right? It optimized the straps for 3 different values, right? It optimized it for 25, it optimized it for 24.9, and it optimized it for 24.96 something. And these are the scaled values, means how your optimization goes on, how the difference or the step size in terms of LP was used. And now you can see the result parameters. This is the initial one. This was the initial one, and this is the best one already correlated with one another, right? So we need not to bother about, because there was none other best value for VSWR over the frequency over the value of LP, because this design has already been designed with the best results so far over the frequency, right? So this is the way of optimization. After closing, after discussing the basic designs, after discussing the parameterization, after discussing the optimizations, let's see what could be a way of having different feeding mechanisms. Let's talk about that very quickly. So if I try to make a coaxial probing, if I try to make a coaxial probing for this particular patch, or if first let's see, if I try to make the CPW feeds, for that I need to delete this port. The coplanar waveguide with ground feeding mechanism, if I need to apply. So for that, what I need to do, I need to add this metallic part over here as well. If I try to show you the geometry of the coplanar waveguide with ground, then this is the geometry of the coplanar waveguide with ground. This would be the geometry. And now this time your geometry would be much related to 50 ohms, and it would be available at 0.787, 2.38. I don't know about G right now, and it is 2.2, and the geometry would impedance would be 37.6. If I make this gap as 0.5, then geometry impedance will be 46.88. And if I make it 6, 47, if I make it 6.5, 48, if I make it 0.7, 48 point, if I make it 0.9, 49.49, and if I make it 0.495, then 49.7, and if I make it 1.0, it is 49.891, 50.2405. So this is something 50 ohm impedance that has to be as per these dimensions. So what I see that this H is already here, this W is already here, and this permittivity is already here. I need to take this G into consideration, right? Only, which is 1.05. So what I can do, I can pick a point over here. I can pick a point over here. I can align the local coordinate system here, you see. And now I can shift this local coordinate system in by, at a gap of 1.05, or I can apply a variable as well. Let's say G1, the gap. Apply, it will ask me what is G1. G1 is 1.05. Okay. And now you see your local coordinate system has been shifted by that much of distance. And now you can create a model starting from here. It would be going up to from 0 to, it would be going up to 10, or it would be going up to 10 minus G1. And it would be going up to, in V, it would be going up to 0 from 10 minus G1. And in V, it would be going from 0 to, if I'm not wrong, 20 minus 1.19 minus G1. And it would be from 0.03. These are the dimensions that I've added, that I have given as per my knowledge, because this was the center of the project. This is 1.19, and this from here to entire range is 20. So I have eliminated this half of the fifth of the feed line. I have eliminated this gap. And if I try to preview it, then you see it is much appropriate. Click OK. So this is the one side of the ground plane. And similar sort of thing can be added up on the other side. It can be transformed in V with a copy with the dimensions of WF, width of the feed line was copied in with negatives, as well twice of G1 minus this entire length, which is 20. If I try to check it out, it is already here. So this sort of feed line you can create. Okay. So it is to be shifted quite more. Okay, fine. Now this is CPW with ground. CPW with ground. Ground is already there, right? So now you can apply the excited port over here again on the face. At this face, you can go into homes, macros, and follow the same process, right? This is another way. You can excite it, excite the patch through coaxial probing as well. For creating the coaxial probing, let me show you something. For that, first you need to create an inner conductor, which is a slender, and it would be starting from, let's make this cancel now. Okay, fine. It would be starting from, let's say it is D, and it should go from 0 to 0.035 plus 0.787 plus 0.035. That means it should start from the patch, and it should go up to covering the patch. It should cover up substrate and the ground plane as well. Preview, D is 0.065. Okay, and now you see here it is. This is on the top. So making it as negative of everything let's preview it should be z 0 2 0 0 Okay. Now you see, this is your conductor that is touching the patch, that is cutting the substrate, and that is cutting the ground plane. Right? You see, it is starting from here and it is going up to this side. That means it is covering the entire design of the patch, ground plane, and the substrate. Now, to cover through it using a dielectric, what you need to do is you need to create another model, and that would be going up to. It would be in the z direction again. It would be having a radius of r n, let's say. The center would be zero, and it would be going from zero to it should cover the ground plane, which is having a thickness of 0.035. It should cover the patch as substrate as well, but it should not cover the patch. That means it should not enter into patch. The material would be dielectric, say RT 580 is enough. RN would be 2.243. Okay. And now it is asking to apply some Boolean operation. So you see, RT 580 and ground, it should insert. Okay, because both are having the different materials. Now RT and RT both are the same, so it can be added up. And now finally, what it should do with the pin, it should do nothing with the pin. Okay. And now you see, this is your coaxial probing. And last but not the least, you need to apply the waveguide port over the face here. You need to apply the waveguide port. Just click OK. And your this is just a random geometry. It should be at the position where the 50 ohm impedance point would be lying on the patch, right? So I'll show you very quickly the results of three geometries that I have just shown you. So I have a design of the same patch with three different geometries. I have tried to compare the results of three different geometries for you guys. I have simulated it through the insert feeding mechanism. I have simulated it through the coaxial probing, and I have simulated it through the CPW feed. And if I try to show you the results, then I have saved a folder called compare. And this is the return loss that we were having through insert feed that we have modeled for the demonstrations. Then this is the return loss of the CPW feed. If you see, then a very small shift in the frequency is there, right? You can notice a very small shift in the frequency, and this is the return loss through coaxial probing. These are the three comparisons of the three feeding mechanisms over on the patch. One was having a return loss at 4.92, one was having a return loss at 4.95, and the coaxial probing was having a return loss at 4.8. And similarly, these are the three gains over frequencies for three different feeding mechanisms. So what I can conclude is that insert feed is the best because it is having a value of return loss with the maximum one, if you can notice. If you can notice, then this is the final one. Right? So this sort of comparisons you people can do. Also, if I now I talk about something through presentations because I am not having much enough time. So I'll talk about something through presentations. So this is what I have shown you. This is the polar plot of the patch that we have created. Now let's talk about a very few concepts about the polarization concept, right? Everyone knows polarization defines the orientation of the electric field vector, and these are the basic polarization techniques. The class of polarizations that we need to look over here in the designs. So this is the patch that we have created through insect feeding, and this is the polarization, linear polarization it is following. But now, if I try to create a circular polarization with this much of 20 cross 20 size of the patch, then how it could be? Then it could be like this. This is one of the method to develop a coaxial circularly polarized patch antenna. This is one of the way. And if I try to show you the dimension, this would be the dimensions, and this is circular polarization. This is circular polarization. If you can visualize it, the field vector is, this is E field vector. It is rotating in anti-clockwise direction, and you better know what is anti-clockwise. If it is rotating counterclockwise, then what it would be, either RHCP or LHCP, or if you are if it is rotating clockwise, then what it would be, right? This is one of the way, and this is the axial ratio plot of this particular antenna that we have created. It is well below within the range of 3 dB. And this is the definition says for circularly polarized antenna that your axial ratio should lie within the range to 0 to 3 dB. And it is something like that only, right? If I try to show you another way of creating circularly polarized antenna, then what it would be? This would be, you apply a patch, you create a patch, you feed it through coaxial probing, and you truncate the corners. So I have truncated the corners in two ways. First, I truncated the corners this way, and then I truncated the corners this way, and the class of polarization changes. How? You can see the results were same, that reflection coefficient was same, but yes, the polarization, class of polarization varies. You see both the, and both of the animations, the field vectors are rotating oppositely, right? This is clockwise, this the very first one is clockwise, and this is anti-clockwise, right? So this is another way of having CP antenna, that you apply a coaxial probe and you truncate the corners at very respective positions, and you try to develop a CP antenna. And another way of having, this is much more famous for having circularly polarized antenna, is you excite the antenna through two different schemes. If I show you the design, if I am having, because it is not completely shown in the presentation or on the slide. So in this design, I have used two excitations. You see, I have used two excitations, two excitational ports I have used on the same patch. But yes, both the patches, both the excitations are having a difference of 90 degrees in terms of phase shift. If I show you how is it, then you see both the excitations are having a shift of 90 degrees among themselves to develop or to generate the orthogonal mode that will create CP. And if I try to show you that CP, if I try to show you the CP, then you people can notice, this is for the port number one. This is somewhat CP, and this is the port number two, somewhat CP. So these are the few ways that you people can generate circularly polarized patch antenna. And this is the result of this polarized patch antenna that we have created. This is, I guess, if I request Hanumanta sir to please come in, because we are not having enough time. I need sir. To wind. Yeah. Sir, should I continue or wind it up for this session?
How much time is required, sir?
I can think. So 5 minutes.
5 minutes is not a problem, sir.
Okay.
Please
okay.
Continue, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Now, guys, let's have a few of the modeling concepts, few of the advanced modeling concepts into the picture. Very quickly, we'll see through CST, we'll see the application of lofting operation, we'll see the application of shelling operation. And now I'm creating a horn antenna very quickly. Waveguide horn antenna I'll create. It is in time domain because it is having a broadband characteristics. So it would be having, as everyone knows that horn antenna works well at the frequency range of X band, which is 8 to 12 gigahertz, more appropriately, E field, H field, and all other things are there. Next, okay. If I try to show you the dimensions of the horn that we would be modeling now, would be like this. The rectangular waveguide would be having a dimensions of 1 × 0.5 × 0.5. The radius of the circular mouth would be 1.5, and the length of the intermediate part would be 2, and all these dimensions are inches. So if I try to check whether my project is in inches, no, my project is in millimeters. So I can change the dimensions. I can change the dimensions into inches. Okay, fine, apply. Now, first I need to create a rectangular waveguide. For that, again, a brick, means name it as base. The dimensions would be from 1 × 0.5 × 0.5. So it should start from -0.5 to 0.5, keeping the symmetry. -0.25 to 0.25, and z mean from 0 to 0.5. Having a material of PEC, or you can have any of the practical materials from the library. Let's have a preview. This is the rectangular waveguide. This is this sort of base. This one, this is the base of the geometry of the horn. Now I need to create a circular mouth, a cylindrical part of this horn antenna, which should be at the far distance. So what I can do, I can pick a point over here. I can pick a point, a face center I can pick. I can pick a face center. I can activate the local coordinate system, which is at this position. And now if you align it with the WCS, so it is now at this position. Now I can transform this local coordinate system in the direction of W with a distance of 2 inches. Okay. Now what I can create? I can create a cylinder with a radius of, I guess, 1.25. Yeah, 1.5. The cylinder would having a radius of 1.5 with a thickness of 0.1. Let's have a preview. Okay. Now you see, these are the two different objects placed at a distance apart from one another. So now I need to apply loft operation to create or to develop the intermediate geometry between them. So for that, what I need to do is, I need to pick this face, the inner face of the cylinder. I need to pick this face, the inner part of the rectangular waveguide, and just apply this lofting. This is the loft operation. Just apply this, nothing to do with it. And now you see automatically the intermediate geometry has been created. And now, these are the three different objects. If you see the base, the solid one, the circular mouth, and the intermediate geometry. What I need to do? I need to perform shelling now in order to make it hollow. So for that reasons, I need to, as I said in the slides, that for performing shelling, first I need to add the components into one. So what I can do, I can select all three. I can perform a Boolean add. And now you see it is a complete geometry. Now what I can do, I need to perform the shelling. So I need to pick the faces from where to where I need to perform the shelling. So for that, I am picking the face, this one. And similarly, I have picked this face, this one. And now shelling, it is available in shape tools. Shell solid. And now I can perform shelling in different directions. If I perform it, if I am able to show you, then you try to notice it very cleverly that in how inside shelling is being done. This is inside shelling. Means, okay, let me show you again through preview options. Preview it. It is inside, means it is taking inner part, cutting it from inside, or it is, if it is outside, then you can see it is going outside in the outward direction. So I'll opting if this is outside direction shelling. Why is it so? Because if I opt the inside shelling, then the diameter, which is 3 inches right now, would be shifted to 2.98 only. If I pick inside shelling, so I perform okay. And now you see, this structure is completely hollow now. The last thing that is only left to apply, that is excitation. So for that, I need to pick a point. I have picked this point. Now I need to pick an edge. I have picked this. And now I can enter into simulation. I can apply a waveguide port and just apply it. And you see, this is your waveguide port now. This is your complete geometry of the horn. And if I show you the results of this particular horn antenna through the design that I have created, this is very similar design that we have created just now. Yeah, this is the horn that we have created just now. And if I show you the results, the very first that will show you is the return loss. And if you try to notice that it is possessing the broadband characteristics because it is performing well beyond the limits of 10 dB of the return loss for the entire range of the frequency. That is why it is broadband characteristics. That is what I said, that horn possesses the broadband characteristics, right? And if I try to show you the VSWR of this horn, and it is well within the range from 1 to 2. It is well within the range of theoretical values. And now if I try to show you the E-field patterns, now you see, now these are the E-field, not appropriately visible. And now you can visualize them. E-fields. These are the E-fields. And if I try to show you something more, these are the H fields, right? And now last but not the least, if I try, as you all know that horn antenna possesses the directional properties as well. That means it directs the energy into very specified direction with the maximum in output. And if I try to show such thing, then you see, this is the directional property of the horn that you have created. It is having a directivity of 16.4 dBi, very higher, right? 16.4 dBi is the directivity of this particular horn, and the gain, which is not of that much importance in while I talk about the gain, so this is 16.3 dBi, right? So this is something, and now if I try to show you the cross pole and co-pole of this horn, then from where you obtain that cross pole and co-pole. So in the far field plots on the same window, you have these options, isotropic, linear directional, or linear omnidirectional. So to have the cross or co, you just click on linear directional. And you see, this is your co-pole in terms of directivity, if I show you. This is your co-pole, and this is your cross pole of the horn. And if in polars, if you want to see the same thing, then this is the cross and this is your co-pole for the horn. This is very important in terms of the antennas where you look for some advanced results, right? And this, because it's a testing instrument, it can be working as a reference. So cross and pole is much more of higher importance, right? So this is what you people can perform, you people can do. This was all about the basics of CST in terms of antennas. And in the next session, we will go up to through higher a few advanced designs in terms of MIMO concepts. We'll see, right? So if I request Hanumanta sir to please come in.
Yes, sir. Some of the participants asked us some questions.
Sure, sir, we'll take them. Yeah.
Wait, sir, please.
Yeah, sure, sir.
The question is, what is the difference between hexahedral and a tetrahedral meshing, sir?
Sir, these are depending over the number of edges over the solids, right? If I distribute a structure into different solids, then it would be following with the number of different number of edges, right? And if you can Google and then Google it, then hexahedrons would be having 6 different faces and tetrahedrons would be having 4 different faces.
Now, the second question is, sir, for a periodic array, how to model unit cell in the hexagonal array like a honeycomb structure?
I can show you through some simulations in the next session, because through some design or modeling, I'll show you, because we will be talking about some arrays in the next session.
Yes, yes, sir. So therefore, similarly, the question is, Karthik sir, you are there?
Yeah, I am here only, sir. Yeah.
So can you please take an example for perfect LHCP or RHCP antenna with required parameters?
Sir, this is what I have just shown. If you have noticed, then this is a perfect example of LHCP and RHCP.
Yes.
This patch is having the dimensions that we have just modeled in the day, right? The patch was having the dimension of 20 cross 20 cross 0.035. The substrate was having the dimensions of 40 cross 40.787, right? The thing that we have created, that we have used the same coaxial probing as well, but we have created the slots, the truncations are of the corners at two different cross sides, right? So yes. This is the perfect example.
Yes. How to give the feed from SMA connector?
So this is what I have shown you. If I can show you through SMA connector, then SMA connector is created quite similarly with that coaxial connector, right? Rather, you need to do is, you need to take the pin that is about to touch the feed line a quite longer while we compare the substrate and the upper conductor. You need to take that pin quite longer and you need to put that pin on the feed line. I'll try to develop a design in the break if I could.
Okay, sir. One more is, how can we observe Smith chart in CST?
Okay, for any of the designs, if you see, if I can show you, just give me a minute. If this is the return loss for this horn, then it can't be visualized through this Smith chart option. Now you people can better analyze it, because I can only give you the idea on the CST. You better apply your theoretical concepts over it to justify. This is admittance view. You can check the impedance and admittance view from here only on over the Smith charts.
Yes.
Next, sir.
Sir, please show how to create vias and how to duplicate it along the line or axis.
Okay, this is for substrate integrated waveguide sort of applications, I guess. So, if I show you something through simulations, and if I have shown you something through simulations, if I am having some design. Vias are actually nothing but the cylindrical structures, right? These are nothing but the cylindrical structures. So what you can do, you can activate your local coordinate system at any of the points. If I try to show you. Then, okay, fine. If I pick this point. Yeah, I have picked this point. I have activated the local coordinate system on this point. Now, if I move this local coordinate system within the structure somehow, then what it would be, I move it by one in U. Negative of two. One in U and one in V. Then it is something there. Okay. And now I can create a cylinder over there. With, let's say, a size of one, radius of one, and with the thickness. Now, if you have noticed that I picked the lower point of the patch, I picked this particular point, right? And if you see the local coordinate system is lying at the lower part of the patch. So from there itself, you can model a via of covering the substrate only, right? And it would be having a metallic part. Okay, delete. And if you can see, it is something here. If I show you, then this thing you can create, and you can now, I'm not appropriate with the geometry, and now you can transform it in any of the directions. Suppose you need to transform that with a repetition factor of 10 or 5 in V with a distance of 1.5. Right, with a distance of 1.5 and with the copy factor, and should have a distance of 2 or 2.5. Now you see it can be duplicated, right? It could be duplicated, just apply. And similarly, it could be duplicated in U as well with a distance of 2.5 with a repetition factor of 5 preview. Oh, sorry, it would be negative of U. Preview. Okay. So now you see these are duplicated in different directions and may not be appropriate with the geometry. Now this way you can create the vias in their structure. And you can perform Boolean operations over them as well. Yes, next, sir.
Sir, one question is, please explain eigen solver.
Okay, we'll have a brief overview of the eigen solver in detail in the next session. I'll try to cover, because everything is not possible in to cover in just 2 hours of the time.
Yes, yes, yes. Sir, how to draw the lumped circuit of designed antenna in CST? Please design one example with complete optimization process.
There is none of the studios or solvers or EM simulator available in the market that can directly give you the lumped circuit or equivalent circuit of the any of the antennas, right? CSG can provide you some partial inductance, capacitances or resistance values that you people can use to create the netlist, and that netlist can be imported on PSpice or Cadence or Proteus to create the circuits as well. None of the simulators can exactly provide you the equivalent circuit.
Sir, can you kindly give the dimensions used to generate the CP antenna?
Sir, I told you, I have done nothing very special to create this CP antenna. What I could do, what I did, that the dimensions would remain the same, 40 cross 40 cross 40 yes, cross ground and substrate, 20 cross 20 for the patch. And these slots are cut with the dimensions of 1.524. And thereafter, these slots dimensions were optimized to have the best view.
This is the question, sir. What is minus 40 occurrence in CST? How much occurrence is correct? Accuracy.
Okay.
What is minus 40 accuracy in CST? How much accuracy is correct?
I got it. If I try to show you that in every solver, there is an option for accuracy. That means up to what sort of energy level it would simulate, right? So it has different slabs. So once it meets the minus 40 dB accuracy, it will stop the simulation. It is available herein. If I try to show you through the simulated design, then you see in this particular design, the accuracy has been achieved up to minus 40 dBs, and after that the simulation stops. So as long as you improve the accuracy level, as you reaches up to minus 80 dB, your simulation time will increase, right? So you need to have the accuracy. Generally, actually, what is there? Let me give you a very basic concept over CST, that whatever the input specifications in terms of the solver settings, in terms of the boundary conditions, in terms of the background materials have been provided you by CST. Actually, for every application template, for every application solver, CST has its own boundary conditions, CST has its own solver settings depending over your applications. So you better follow, you for the initial simulation, for the very first simulation, you better follow the settings provided by CST to you automatically. Thereafter, you can change a bit in the settings, in the mesh cells, in the mesh size. You can thereafter make the changes to have the better results. but it is recommended to use the initial settings provided by CSC window templates only. Next.
Sir, is it possible to derive copolarization and cross-polarization using E-plane and H-plane?
So this is what I just shown you.
Yeah.
This is what I just shown you. This is the cross-pole. This is the copole, and depending over this value of phi, you can define E-plane and H-plane. Right, you can set this phi is equals to 90 to phi is equals to 0, and now you are on the other plane.
And the last question, sir, you have constructed a wave port smaller, but usually it will be extended much higher dimensions for yes. Wave port. Please comment on this.
Sir, when I was modeling the wave port for the patch antenna, I commented there as well that where we have the very thinner faces over which the wave port is very smaller in size, then what happens when it goes for the meshing criteria, then that wave port will not be meshed up properly because of this very smaller in size. That is why we have a macro through which we can extend the wave port by a factor of k that I shown you the extension coefficient, which was 8.39 in our case of the patch. So when you extend the port, then it means it can be discretized or it can be meshed up properly in order to give you the appropriate results.
Sir, one more participant raised that. Hanmantrao, sir, you are raised that hand. You want to ask anything? Hanmantrao Bhandari, sir. Are you there, sir?
Hello.
Sir, you want to ask something because you raised your hand.
So this is me, Karthik Goyal.
Karthik, okay. Hanmantrao, sir. Hanmantrao Bhandari. Please, if you want to ask, you can ask now. I don't know, sir. No questions are there. This session we will conclude. Okay. Thank you, Karthik. Especially I worked on both platforms as an HFSS and CST. I learned some of the important points which I should be regularly where we are observed the comments. I learned something in this particular case especially from my side. Similarly, I'm expected from all the participants. This is a very useful session, I say especially. And in the afternoon also, it is a very important as a multiple input, multiple output designs is there. MIMO sessions are going on. I'm very much thankful to you, sir, once again. And we will again start the session, the afternoon session, sharply at 2 o'clock, sir.
Sure, sir. Sure.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. We will meet at 2 o'clock.